I'm so happy. Amen. I'm so glad to say goodbye to last year. You know, and I'm so thankful to be with my church family this year. Amen. You know, and I'm doubly thankful. I want to thank Mike because I had the worst headache. And he did some, like, gave me a massage on my back, and it is gone, praise the Lord. Amen. And Matt, I send him the slides, but I try, but they're never ready on time, and he still got them up. And I mention that because you know how you just spent the holidays with your family and they got on your nerves, but they're your family and you love them. This is our family. We sometimes get on each other's nerves, but we so need each other. Amen. Like, it's just huge. And I want to start the year off remembering that. So if we can all remember that we all need each other, when we get on each other's nerves later, okay, and this totally ties in the sermon, we got to remember and believe God's going to save all of us. Amen. That's what he did to the children of Israel. Let's talk about our sermon today. The word I have for you is called Speak to the Rock. Okay, and there's three lessons I want you to remember. Three things I want you to remember. Obey God. I should say, especially when you don't understand. Just obey God. Make that your just rule of thumb. Okay? Talk to Jesus. Okay? These aren't in order of importance. They're just things you need to remember. Obey God, talk to Jesus, and speak to others out of love. Now, number three really comes from a number that's not up there, because it's just about remembering how much God loves you and doing the same to others. But speak to others out of love. Okay? So hold on to those. Now, here's the setup that God is trying to teach us this. There's some other lessons in this story, but these are the three I want to focus on today. So I want you to, Numbers chapter 20, verse 1 through 7. It's all really important. This is the setup. Okay, it says, then, I'm going to read from the, I think up there is NIV. It says, in the first month, the whole Israelite community arrived at the desert of Zin. Feedback. At the desert of Zin. And they stayed at Kadesh. Now, they've been at Kadesh before. You might remember. That's where God first had the water from the rock come out. Okay? And Miriam died. And she was buried. Okay? This is a sad moment. Now, there was no water for the community. What happened to the water? It stopped. And the people gathered in opposition to Moses and Aaron, and they quarreled with Moses. They were in his face. Look at what you've done. And they said, if only we had died when our brothers fell before the Lord. Now, notice this is the second generation. They're like, you know how our parents died because they had no faith? Now we're going to die too. Why don't you just let us die too? Why did you bring the Lord's community into this wilderness that we and our livestock should die here? Why did you bring us up out of Egypt to this terrible place? It has no grain or figs or grapevines or pomegranates, and there's no water to drink. Moses and Aaron went from the assembly to the entrance of the tent of meeting and fell face down. And the glory of the Lord appeared to them. This is the setup. What's gone? What's happened? Miriam has died and buried. This is a time of grief. Sometimes when you're super sad, everything is horrible. Have you noticed? If you're sad, one awful, awful thing happens, then everything else is the worst. This is also when the devil decides to bring his worst temptations on you. He's so horrible. But you can overcome. But in this situation, Miriam is a leader. with Moses and Aaron, and she has died. The people are sad and grieving. Aaron and Moses have lost their sister. They're all grieving, and they turn on each other. Okay? And it says that Moses and Aaron don't even say anything. It just says they go before the Lord. And you might think that was a good thing, but we'll get back to you. This is, and God answers. He says, take the staff, and you and your brother Aaron gather the assembly together. Speak to that rock before their eyes, and it will pour out its water. You will bring water out of the rock for the community, so they and their livestock can drink. Fast forward a little bit. He and Aaron gather the assembly together in front of the rock. And Moses said to them, listen, you rebels. Must we bring you water out of this rock? And Moses raised his arm and he struck the rock twice with his staff. Water gushed out and the community and their livestock drank. Does anybody see a problem? Yeah. What's the problem? Somebody raise your hand and tell me what the problem is. Just come and raise your hand, because if you all blurt it out. Go ahead.
Moses overblown the situation.
He overblew the situation.
He was angry.
He was angry. What happened?
He struck the rock.
He struck the rock. How many times did he strike the rock? What was he supposed to do? He was supposed to speak. Now, is it a big deal? Speaking, didn't God answer anyways? Didn't water come out anyways? So what difference does it make?
The taste of
the water. This one is spring water, and this one is tap water. Obedience. Obedience. The problem. But the Lord said to Moses and Aaron, because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I give them. Pause. What does God say the problem is? You did not trust. Would you think that was a trust issue? What? I didn't think it was a trust issue. I just thought it was an obedience issue. Why do you think it? Somebody tell me why they think it's a trust issue. I'm going to pick you back here. Oh, come on. But that's circular reasoning. I mean, yes, that's the right answer. But why would you think, if God hadn't said that, if you had been God and you told Moses to speak to the rock and he struck the rock, I would have said, I told you to speak and I'm just going to punish you. Actually, my mom is really nice. She doesn't really do that, okay? Which is really good, because then I would have been even more rebellious than I already am. Okay. I hate when people, it's so crazy. Something, my flesh, as Paul says, rises up. And those of you who have children, you've said this to your children. Do you see the look of rebellion or that glass look that comes over their face? Okay. God doesn't even deal with that. He says, you didn't trust me. The root of failure to obey is trust. When your kids don't do what you ask them to do, I think sometimes we intuitively know that they disobey because they don't trust us for no good reason. Because who else are they going to trust? Doesn't make any sense. This is what the problem is. They didn't believe God could save the people. Remember back here where it says, the people are complaining, but Moses and Aaron don't say anything. They just go to God. Why don't they speak? Why don't they try to encourage the people? Why don't they try to stop them for their craziness? Because they're sad too. Miriam has just died.
Yeah.
They're grieving. They are weak at this point. One of the inspired writers I love, Ellen White, I love her to death, she writes that they were old. It's just they were old and they gave up. They didn't really believe God could save them. That's why Moses says, "You rebels." He is convicting them. Do you remember earlier on when he was a bit younger, when he was like, you know, 80? And he says, "Lord, spare them and take my life instead." You remember that? Now this is like another 40 years later. And now he says, "You're rebels." He's tired. He and Aaron are both tired. They've seen this all before, and they're weak. And in that moment when we're weak, we have crisis of faith. We feel like we've taken too much. We've seen too much. We've lost too many loved ones. And that's when the devil's like, as he said to Jesus, "If you are." When did he come to Jesus? When Jesus was starving. After 40 days. Do you see the connection? 40 years in the wilderness. Jesus is hungry for 40 days, and he was hungry. And then the devil comes in. Okay? But Jesus didn't say, "I." He said, "Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." He went back to his father. Moses says, "We bring you." Because of his irritation, he did not. Because of his weakness, and he really didn't quite believe. That's why he and Aaron didn't say anything when they complained. They kind of didn't think God could bring these people into the promised land anymore. They really thought, "It's over. God may not bring any water from this rock. Y'all are never going to make it into the promised land." And they were basing that by watching and listening to the complaints of the people. Now, we all do this. I do this, and I'm total testimony. I sometimes get so frustrated. I don't understand what's going on at Wellsprings, and I just give up. I do. I don't know what else to do. It's my lack of faith in God. I get frustrated, and I don't know what to do, and I'm sure you all do. You come to church, and you see everybody's not praying enough. They're not doing what they're supposed to be doing. They're complaining. They're not doing it, and you kind of feel like giving up sometimes. You see it in the global church. Ted Wilson's not acting right. Dan Jackson's not acting right. They don't do these things, and you want to give up. But remember, what has God promised? To bring them into the promised land. Is it based on them? No. It's based on Jesus Christ. He's our faith. He's our righteousness. And if he said it, it will happen. We wonder why the gospel hasn't been spread. Is it going to get spread? It will get spread despite our weakness, despite our problems. The gospel will be spread, and Jesus will come again. Okay? God will save us. He will bring us into our destiny. Wellsprings has a destiny God's going to bring us into despite ourselves. Okay? But what Moses had to do, what he could have done, was just try. It's Ellen White writes, he didn't do his utmost work to make things better before asking God to work for them. I summarize this. Because we think we're just supposed to run and pray. And that's all we're supposed to do. No. We are supposed to work our hardest to bring people back to Jesus when we think that something's wrong. When we see their lack of faith, that's when we go and struggle with them. We do that. You pray while you're doing it, But we have that work. We don't need no special extra dispensation from God to go say, Jesus loves you. I see that some things that you seem to be lacking faith, or I see something wrong. Let me tell you, God will supply all of your needs. Do we do that? That's what we have to do. I know, I give you my testimony. This totally convicted me the other day. I was like, how many times have I gone to God and God is like, Tammy, you know like a 20 Psalms in your head. You couldn't have quoted a couple? But they were wrong. And he's like, and that's why I let you remember like 20 Psalms. I was like, ooh, I'm so focused on my hurt feelings or my frustration. And guess what? It's not about me. We take things personally. But remember when the people asked for a king and Samuel was frustrated? Was it about Samuel? No, God said, they're rejecting me. We gotta stop taking it personal. People aren't thinking about us. They got too many other issues. We need to think about God when they forget. And maybe they think we're not thinking about God and they think we've forgotten. But if we both come up and we bring the one text that we remember, even if it's our own personal translation, and we share that word of encouragement, whew, we all come together, right? In the word of the Lord. Moses and Aaron forgot in their moment of weakness. It's understandable. And God had mercy and he answered them. But there were consequences. But when you lack faith to believe that God can save someone, that is the root of our problem with judgment. And that's actually when we also fail to obey ourselves. We don't do exactly what God asked us to do. And we remember God's got a plan. Moses didn't know what God was planning. He didn't know that he was messing it up. He was thinking, there's just water. They need water. I'm going to get some water out of the rock. We think we want the church to grow. We think we want so-and-so to be in a peaceful situation and he or she's causing drama in their lives. I want so-and-so off of this. I want them off of that. I want them to stop doing this. But God has a plan. 1 Corinthians 10:4 tells us in Moses' situation that God had a plan. That rock was not just a rock. The rock was Christ. Jesus Christ was one time crucified. God had an example, a lesson in progress. He was acting out through Moses. How many times has God been acting out a lesson for the universe in your life? That later on you're going to get and it's for you too. How many times we just, you know, Jesus Christ, one time crucified. It says Christ suffered for our sins once for all time. He never sinned, but he died for sinners to bring you safely home to God. Moses had the opportunity to act that out for the children of Israel just by speaking to the rock. For God's will was for us to be made holy by the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once for all time. God's will. Did God make the children of Israel holy? Yeah, he did. He did. Did the Messiah come through them? Yes, he did. Did they keep messing up? Yes, they did. But the plan happened. And it says, now we only have to ask for blessings in the name of Jesus. We don't have to yell at God. Now you might, and it's not a sin. But you don't have to. You don't have to. You know, I've been to some churches, and they feel like they got to order God around to get a blessing. God, you must do this. Whoa! I always get a little scared. You have to do all that. It said, Jesus told us in John chapter 14, 13 through 14, you can ask for anything in my name, and I will do it, so that the Son can bring glory to the Father. It's not, the way you ask for it. You don't have to make God do anything. You don't even have to suffer more for God to do it. Christ has died and risen and sits on the throne next to the Father. All we have to do is ask. It's easy. And that's why God wanted Moses to just speak to the rock. Speak to the rock and the water comes out. That's our lesson for life. If we could just speak to people a word from the Lord about how God loves them, how he's encouraging them, how they're about to make a choice. But if they just believed that God loved them and he had a plan and he was going to fix it, they'd make a different choice. You think they don't know? Back in Genesis, it tells us that God said he would put enmity in us against the serpent. It's already here. They already feel convicted. They already feel guilty. That's why they struggle. We just need to reaffirm them that God loves them. He's got strength to overcome. He's died for them. He's resurrected and offers them all the power of heaven to overcome anything that they feel like is keeping them down and hurting them and abusing them, because they feel like they have to make a bad choice for something good to happen. They've given up. But we haven't given up, because we know that this rock is Christ and he is our strong, sure foundation. We can do this. So whenever you see, this is my New Year resolution, that I will not give up. I will not give up. I will be strong in the Lord. I will. Can you make that resolution this year? I will not get up. Give up. Let's say, I will not give up. My rock is Christ. My rock is Christ. Come on now. Is your rock Christ or not? My rock is Christ. My rock is Christ. Sure foundation. Moses said, you rebels. Sounds like the accuser of the brethren. He was irritated. He was, naturally, we think, oh, you know, we think it's natural to be irritated. I'm just human. That's why I'm mad. I'm human. I made a mistake. Did you know it's not really human to want to, like, be irritated at someone and to call them names? Did you know that that's sin? And we were called to be like God. And instead, we're supposed to give love when we see that someone is hurting. Hurting people do hurtful things. Happy people do happy things. That irritated feeling, that human passion, is not holy indignation. Your anger that somebody may dishonor God does not mean it is holy indignation. Holy indignation is, look at this. This is a horrible thing. This person needs to know how much God loves them. The devil got them. Holy indignation is a hate of sin and a love of a sinner. Most of us really don't know what that's like. I gotta be real. It's hard for us to distinguish between the two, but it comes out in your actions. Compare Jesus to the woman caught in adultery. He says, who condemns you? Go and sin no more. Does he even need to tell her what the sin is? No. He enabled her and equipped her by loving her in the face of judgment. How to love a sinner. This is the hard part. At least to me, this is the real hard part. Judge the sin, not the person. The first easy step is no name calling, even in your mind. Right? No. Don't think that. Lord, give me a new thought. Give me a new thought for this person. Address the root of the problem. Their problem is not the sin. Their problem is their lack of belief in God to meet their need. When you see your brother or sister about to break a law or in the progress and the process, why are they doing that? Because they think they can't find happiness. They can't find joy. They can't satisfy that heart longing because God won't do it. we have to reassure them God will do it more than they can imagine. And abundantly in their cup will overflow. That's what we have to reassure them. We have to encourage them in the Lord. We have to give them the promises of God's faithfulness. I used to keep, and I want to encourage all of you to do this. When you get your, to this afternoon, it's Saturday. Most of us don't have anything to do. Go into, look in the back of each one of the, all those little letters in the New Testament, James and Peter and Paul's books, and he gives all these little blessings. Cut out pieces of those and put them in your phone and make a list, God's promises, encouraging words. And then when you meet somebody who's having a bad day, you can quickly scroll to it. And you don't have to quote it like they know it's a Bible text if you think that's weird. Just say it in your own words to them. You know, Philippians 4:19, and the same God who takes care of me will supply all your needs from his glorious riches, which have been given to us in Christ Jesus. Find something. They're all over the place. And just take them. And sometimes you'll find yourself going to them when you feel bad. God, those are promises people need. Christian or not Christian, believe it or not, a lot of non-Christians would really appreciate to get a blessing. Say, hey, you know what? God's going to take care of you. He loves you. He's got you. I just want to encourage you. I want to encourage you in the name of the Lord. Let me bless you. Very few people will turn down a blessing if they don't believe in God. They'll take blessings from anywhere they can get it. Yeah, you could say you were Buddhist and they take the blessing. You could say you were whatever and they'd be like, you want to bless me? Bless me. I need all the blessings I can get. So how much more is this your chance for them to remember that God wants to bless them with the rain and the sunshine and in their life, supply all their needs? Do that. Then after you've done all you can, and they still won't turn from their wicked ways, then you go fall down on your face before God and say, you need to do something crazy. You need to do something miraculous. You need to correct them, Lord. Notice I said, Lord, you need to correct them. I've given the word of encouragement. I've showed them a text to build them up and strengthen them. I've done all I can do. I don't know anything else. I've tried to remind them of your faithfulness. And when they still won't listen, then you commit them to the hands of a loving, all-powerful God who will do more than you can ask or ever imagine for them. This is the kind of love that God has for us. He doesn't usually come out the box with a stick. He comes out the box calling, where are you? Where are you? Jesus came as a baby. Can you hold a baby? Well, before it throws up on you or pees on you, can you hold a baby and not like feel like, wow? And some people, they get scared when they hold the baby because it's so amazing and so precious. They're overwhelmed by such a small little person. Jesus came because he says, my love is given to you like this baby. Handed to you for your care. Handed for you to pass it on so other people can kiss me and hold me. That's what Jesus wants to do for us all year long, and he wants to do us to do it to each other. Moses led an amazing life. From a murderer, from a baby who was going to be murdered, to a man who murdered, to a sheep herder, who saved some young ladies at a well, okay? To a man who disobeyed God and his sons almost died, to a man who leads God's people out of slavery. This is so cool. To a man who's willing to die for a group of people who themselves would have murdered him. To a man who sees God's face, and finally, to a very old man who's tired makes a mistake. But I want to remember something. I felt somewhat unjust by using Moses as an example of someone who failed. Because through Moses, God delivered his people. Through Moses and Aaron and Miriam, and they all messed up. But they did so much good in their lives. Moses, in the end, he sees the promised land and he dies. This is tragic. But do you know what happens? You all know what happens. He gets resurrected. And he ministers to the promised Messiah. And he gets to the kingdom and beats all of us. He gets the real deal. Because God is faithful. Remember, God is faithful. If your friend, your loved one, is the thief on the cross and they've been messing up, I want you to know something. The thief on the cross is immortalized. He didn't accept Jesus till the last minute. And how many people have come to Christ before the last minute because of one man on a cross who said, God, remember me? How many people God redeemed his whole life in a moment? God will and can save those you pray for. And parents, I want to encourage you in this new year, especially that you've been praying for children that you don't think are going to make it in the kingdom. You're afraid that they have not been saved. This year, I want to encourage you, don't give up. God has promises. He says, you guys know some of those promises. God talks about if you raise up a child in the way he should go, they will not, when they are old, they will not turn from it. What do you think the thief on the cross parents thought? They thought it was too late. Good Jewish boy. They raised up the best they could. Remember that. Remember the Lord says he will restore the years the locusts are eaten. Some of you have married people, and it says that in the New Testament, it says that the consecrated husband or wife will save their family, will save their spouse. Mm-hmm. Hold to those promises and do not give up. You do your best, God does the rest. God is faithful. He will complete it. Speak to the rock. Speak to the rock this new year. He will be your sure foundation. Shall we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, wow, in Jesus' name we come to you. We come to you in Jesus' name because you can't resist Jesus. Let your spirit fill us this new year. Remind us each day to ask for more. Holy Father, let your love pour in us that we might pour it upon others. Encourage us this day that we would not lose faith, but that we would remember the faith of Jesus Christ and call on your name moment by moment. Keep us in the way. Keep us safe in this rain. Keep our loved ones safe. Father God, and we give ourselves completely over to you because you love us. We ask for your love more. We ask for your blessings. In Jesus' name.